Hey, good morning, everybody. Good morning. Come on in. Grab your seats or grab your coffee, then your seats. That'd probably be good. But come on in. Stop that jibber-jabbing. Get those heinies in those. What's another word that rhymes with heinie for seat? I don't know. Come on in. Have a seat. We'll get started here in a second. Thanks, guys. So, good morning. I'm John Torres. I'm with City Ministry Network. And today we get to gather for our Catalyst monthly meeting. So, we're excited about that. There's three things that I'm going to ask of you before we get started here. Number one, there's sign-in sheets at your table. If you could sign in for me at the table, that would be great. I know some of you have done it a million times. We just love seeing your handwriting. It's so beautiful and pretty, and I like trying to figure out your names when I can't read your writing, so please do that for us. So get your information there. Number two, if you're on the face, on the gram, those Facebook and Instagram, in case you didn't know, or Twitter, if you could check in, that would be amazing. So we can show your friends or let your friends know what's going on, what you're doing, so they can be jealous that you're here and they're not. Man, I'm getting no laughs. That's all right. We'll work it out. If I can get some feedback from you, we would love to get feedback from you. So at your tables, there should be a plastic covered sheet. What is that called? There he is, laminated sheet that should show you how to do that. Or there's a piece of paper that you can give us some feedback, and that would be awesome. Now, I'm going to read this verbatim because this is kind of our call sign or our motto for Catalyst. So Catalyst is a place for community connection that matters. Our hope is that you will connect with others who share your vision or passion, begin to build trust, and collaborate together to impact our community in some way. So before we hear from our speakers, Kourtney, James, and Leah, our presenters today, we want to spend a few minutes at the table getting to know each other. And so we have two questions for you guys to discuss. They should be behind me. Just kidding. Not yet. I'll just read the questions, and then hopefully they'll end up behind me. So the two questions are, how would you define mental health? And the second question is, do you think your workplace cares about your mental health? Hey, there they are. So if you could talk about those at your table, give each other time to talk. I know Joe likes to talk a lot, so if you're at Joe Duran's table, just tell him, hey, can I go now, please? That would be great. No, go ahead and spend a couple minutes at your table, and I'll tell you when to be quiet. All right. Well, we're taking a team approach this morning and looking at the topic of building a healthy workplace culture. Oh, there we go. Now you can see my ugly mug. Great. So this morning, we're going to kick this off with one of my homegirls. Her name is Kourtney Kauffman, and she is the Director of Family Concern Counseling. So could you welcome her up this morning?
Okay, so I don't usually have notes, or I just look at the questions I'm supposed to read to you guys when I'm up here normally, but I'm trying to keep within like my time limit and not go over and say all the things, and so I did bring little notes. But I am Kourtney, as John said, and I am a marriage and family therapist and the director of family concern counseling. About 4.5 years ago, I took that position as director. Family concern is one of the departments at Youth for Christ, and I had started as a social worker previous to that for about 7 years. And so I was very young, right out of my undergrad, and started this job as a social worker where I was quickly introduced to the team culture that often can be a part of a helping profession. I really received a lot of messages that now I look back and go, oh my gosh, I was really internalizing messages that were not healthy in terms of an emotional workplace environment. And essentially, a lot of those messages were things like, well, if you can last 4 years in mental health, you could last for life, because most people quit by then. I was told things like, well, if they leave at 5, they don't really actually care about the kids in the same way, like they leave on time. Or I was told things like, you know, well, they have a family. They need to go home on time. So as a single person with no kids, right, I started to internalize these messages that really created some unhealthy balance in my life. I found myself feeling exhausted, looking at my to-do list and feeling like I couldn't even tackle one thing on there, even if it took me 2 minutes. My productivity suffered. I even found myself like just having a hard time getting into my work, even though I'd loved it previously. At one point, I even started having nightmares just as a result of the trauma that I was hearing every day. And so I went back to school. I started trying to set some healthy boundaries, but in a culture where that isn't necessarily reinforced, that's hard to do. And so the job at Youth for Christ really gave me an opportunity for growth and for change. And the exciting part for me was that I got to influence a culture and try and create something a little bit different than what I'd come from. I wanted to work in a place where I could actually see employees last longer than 4 years, right, and know that that was the norm. And so I really tried to be intentional about a couple of things. There were those few things. The first thing I did that I really worked hard to do was to come in humbly. I spent the first year, and my team would laugh at me, because I started the first year going, I don't know what I don't know yet. Like, I literally, there are holes in my knowledge that I'm not even aware of. And so I am truly in a learning posture. I did a lot of asking questions about, okay, why do we do things this way? Like, help me understand how we landed at this process. Because we don't land at processes or situations for no reason. Most of the time we've tried a lot of other things. So I tried to learn from the people who were already doing this work, going, okay, what did you already try? So I don't repeat the errors. I tried to listen to voices that were going to be impacted by the decisions I made. I would create a form, and I'd bring it to my staff meeting, and I'd say, okay, guys, beat it up. What do you hate? Which questions are the worst thing you've ever heard, right? Like, which things do you need to toss out the window? Which things are going to add work to your plate? So I worked to set my ego aside, because it wasn't about me. It was about, how do I help my team feel supported, feel heard, and feel engaged in their work? So really trying to just set myself aside and elevate their voices. The second thing I did was I really tried to infuse self-care talk a lot. So my team will probably laugh and roll their eyes, but I say this all the time. I constantly am asking, okay, you're overwhelmed, you're stressed, right? You're feeling like you have too many things, too many balls in the air. How are you going to take care of yourself today? What are you going to do tonight, right? How do you make sure you get enough sleep? And so every conversation I have is infused with that self-care language. I'd make sure to delineate also that self-care and self-comfort are different, right? Self-comfort is Netflix and ice cream for 4 hours because I had a rough day, right? I feel good in the moment, but at the end of the 4 hours, how do you feel? Not good, right? Self-care is healthy decisions that you make that make you healthier tomorrow, right? It's drinking enough water. It's the boring stuff like budgeting. Right? For me, that's one of my self-care strategies. It's getting enough sleep. It's saying no when you need to say no. Right? It's drawing lines in relationships that are draining. And so really making sure that I am educating my team and reinforcing those things. Which brings me to the next thing I tried to do, which was really honor their boundaries. So this is another weird one. But when my team tells me no, like when I come and say, okay, I have a new client, can you take them? Or I have this project, can you help me? And they say, oh gosh, Kourtney, I can't do it right now. I'm too overwhelmed. No, I can't. I literally say to them, thank you. Good job telling me no, and I'm gonna ask again, right? Because my fear when I say no is that all the opportunities are gonna dry up and leave, and I'm never gonna get another opportunity. So I make sure my team knows it's okay to say no, and I'm gonna come back. And the last thing that I tried to do, and this is the one that I probably need to work on a little bit more, so it's sort of like, you know, I guess the preaching to the choir is the right phrase, but do unto others as you would do to yourself. And here's the thing, most of the time, if I did unto my employees what I do to myself, if I required the same work hours, if I had them treat their bodies the way I do, with no lunch and not drinking enough water and not getting enough sleep, if I treated them the way I treat myself, I'd have no employees. We don't take very good care of ourselves as leaders. And some wise people once told me that we reflect our leadership. And so if we're going to ask that our culture is healthy, we also have to be willing to do those things. I have to silence the voice that tells me that leaving at 5 is early. I have to silence the voice that tells me that I can't say no because there's never going to be another opportunity. I have to silence those voices and allow myself to take care of myself, because I think that that's one thing that they watch and try and keep pace. In fact, about 3 months ago, I had my team sit down and we actually filled out a self-care plan. So I had every single one of them do this. I have a team of 18 therapists that I lead. And they all turned their self-care plan into their supervisor. And I had my leadership team turn their self-care plan into me. And we, you know, we're all going to hold each other accountable. It's great. It took me 3 months to realize that I had not made myself a self-care plan. I hadn't done one for myself, right? So as we are leaders and thinking about our teams, that starts with you doing it for yourself. Because if you're only caring for yourself here, it's really hard to care for others as you would care for yourself, right? So how do I know it's working? I don't know for sure. But there's a few things that I've noticed. In the past month, I've had more than 5 of my team members come in and tell me they're overwhelmed, tell me they're going through something, tell me they need support. In fact, in the last 2 weeks, I've had 2 of them come in and say, oh my gosh, I screwed up, I made a huge mistake, and I need your help. They came to their boss to tell her that they made a mistake. To me, that's trust. And so I actually thanked them for telling me about their mistake, which made a few of them laugh, because they're like, who does this? This is weird. And then said, okay, what can we do? Let's work through it. Because if you don't have an environment where they're okay to fail, right, we're not going to learn. So that's the first thing I've been noticing. The second thing I've been noticing is I hear them check on each other in their self-care. So literally, I have used the language so much that now they're doing it to each other, where they're checking and saying, how are you taking care of yourself? I hear you're overwhelmed. You're working too much. Go home. I've heard them say, you have too many clients, right? And so I'm hearing that language outside of my office door, which tells me we're doing something okay. The third thing is that more than 9 of my 18 therapists, more than half of them, have been there longer than 4 years, right? Which I didn't even realize was a goal until I started sitting down going, okay, how do I know it's working? But we have at least broken some of that curse kind of spoken on me when I started working in mental health. And then the last thing, and that's not evidence of my efforts, but in the last 4.5 years, family concern counseling has more than tripled in terms of size, staff, clients we serve, counseling hours that happen in a week. And so for me, what that tells me is I'm leading a team that is engaged in their work, that's devoted to their work, and that feels well supported. So out of those steps, there might be one thing that could be actionable for you. There might be 2 things. But if nothing else, start thinking about how are you being intentional about the emotional health of your team? Because it does make a difference. I am now going to ask that James Bates comes up. He is going to be sharing a little bit about his team and how he has seen emotional health impact them.
I thought I was going to get it introduced as your homeboy, but, you know. So, good morning. So, what's being talked about here in business, it is real. I mean, I know one of the things my business partner and I say, and he's the one that actually coined the phrase, but we didn't start a business so people's lives would get worse. But we forget sometimes as managers, sometimes the stress and the things that we're doing, we actually are making people's lives worse. If all we're doing is talking about business, this deadline, why did this fail? And we're in the cybersecurity business, so it's a high-stress business. We want our employees to have a high level of empathy and understanding when someone's environment gets attacked and can cost them millions of dollars. But yet, do we have empathy for our team? And so we're very intentional about it. And I'd say one of the things that I talked with Mike about, we're saying is you have to be authentic. I can't say, yeah, I need to really care about my team because I read it in a book somewhere. They'll see right through that, and you won't be able to sustain it. So some concrete examples of some things that we do is, one, you touched on the word trust and transparency. You have to, and it has to start with the leaders. So my business partner and I have been friends from 3rd grade. We have a lot of trust and transparency. We have pretty much all the dirt on each other. But what do our teams really know about us as human beings? What are our triggers? What are our weaknesses? What are our faults? So one thing that we've done as an organization is we've actually, and we're still, it's an ongoing process, but there's a book called The Advantage written by Patrick Lencioni. I highly encourage anyone in any organization to do this around organizational health. But it starts with trust and transparency. And we find out that a lot of times there's not enough communication. We just assume people know. They assume that Dave and I bought a new building because why? They want to spend money. It's an investment for them. No, we're doing this because we want to attract more talent. We want a more comfortable work environment. Are we even communicating those things? But you got to start a lot deeper than that. So if you can imagine, we grabbed all of our leaders and part of this book, and I said, okay, we're going to do an exercise in trust and transparency. In that, we actually did an offsite where I asked everyone to come to the house. And I said, we're going to prepare, and we're going to do one cool thing, one super crappy thing, and one informational thing. And the informational thing is, tell me something about your childhood that maybe has shaped how you interact with other people or how you view the world. Well, I could tear up if I told you some of the stories that came out of that. You would never know what our team is carrying, what people are carrying, spouses with diseases, things that happened to them as a child. But I went, the other two parts of it were, we're going to tell each one of us, what's the number one thing you do that strengthens this team? And I said, I want everybody to really pay attention to that, because the crappy part is we're going to tell everybody what you do that detracts from the team, including my business partner and I to each other and to every single person. But you have to understand, in doing that and setting that example as leadership, we're usually walking around with signs on our back that say what those weaknesses are. Other people see them. Sometimes just owning it, but also having a context and an understanding of, where did that come from? Well, maybe your dad always told you you're going to be a loser. So if somebody shoots down your idea in a meeting, you get defensive. Well, when you change that dynamic and start talking about organizational health and actually caring for the person, you say, look, that's not my intent. And that's how I started the meeting off. As I said, my intent and my trust is, you're going to tell me something that may hurt me, may sting a little bit, but I don't think your intent's to hurt me. Your intent's to help me. We're going to make mistakes. So this absolutely, though, turns into increased employee productivity. It turns into higher retention. And we're not perfect by any means. My business partner years ago had a great idea. We use a tool called Office Vibe. It's not perfect, but it sends out regular surveys. And this tool, we're constantly getting feedback. And it doesn't mean that we're a soft organization that's catering to every whim of saying, you know, we're a tech company. We already got a ping pong table and a basketball hoop and an electric skateboard and all this other stuff. So it's like, you know, when an idea says, hey, you know, I'd really feel better if I had a popcorn machine at my desk, that doesn't mean we go do that. But when somebody says, hey, I see that we're making a lot of profit, I see that we're growing, but I'm still not clear on the vision of the company, I should talk to them about that. Because we're missing something in our communication. And if they understand that vision and they're part of it, you're going to see a different level of engagement. You're going to see that transcend to your customers or your clientele. So this is tangible. It's not just a fluff, feel good. It's a never-ending process. But I feel great. I'll tell you, it makes a huge difference. I had a meeting yesterday where I went to someone. I said, you're going to burn out. And this person is amazing. They're killing it, but they're also killing themselves. And them just knowing, hey, I'm going to intentionally take these couple things off your plate because you're doing fantastic at all these things, but it's not sustainable because I want you here for the long run. And what this turns into is spouses coming up to us at Christmas parties saying, my spouse has never been like this at home. They're actually relaxed. We're not arguing as much. Well, that goes back to the question of, are you making people's lives worse or better? So we're not going to get it right all the time. We're going to screw up. But we got to be honest and transparent to say, you're spending more of your time here with us many times than you are with your family. So this is it's an emotional topic for me because I care. So I encourage you guys to not just read a book or think, okay, how's this going to create more profit, or it's just another box. Take a baby step. Read a book. Talk to your team. Hey, is there anything going on? And just keep following up. I mean, one of our office vibe feedback was just last week. I can tell the owners actually care because they come back and they talk to me about nothing. They're not just, they want to know who I am as a human being. They're actually seen. But guess what? When the stuff hits the fan and a client goes down, that team will support each other. They'll jump in. They'll take bullets for each other. They'll do whatever it takes because they know they're part of a team that cares about their health and their mental health, and we want them to go home and have a great time with their family and enjoy where they work. So we work hard, we play hard, but we care hard. And with that, I'm going to introduce my great colleague, Leah.
All right. So if some of you are wondering, okay, where do I start? How do I do this with my team? In my 20 years in HR with Gallo, what I found is kind of what they've been talking about here is the more you get to know each other, it helps build morale, it helps build trust within the group. And one of the key things I think, and I got this from Marvin, is recognizing that each one of your employees is unique. I think often we think that, you know, oh, you should be like Bob, you should do it like Mary, you should all do it the same way or do it like I do it. You should make sure you do that. But every single person is unique. And so their shape is different. Every person is born with natural gifts and abilities, whether they're an encourager or they're more generous or they're a helper. Some of that just comes naturally when they're born. Then they develop passions, things that they're excited about, things that motivate them. And that's different from person to person. And then, of course, we all have different abilities. Some are more mathematical than others, like me, not so much. Some are more mechanical. Some are more verbal. Being aware of that as you get to know your employees. And then, of course, everybody has a different personality, and there are tons of assessments out there that can help you get to know that about each other in the workplace. And then, of course, every single person, as James was saying, has their life experiences, how they grew up in their family, and what they're dealing with now, whether they have parents they're having to take care of or a child with a disability. And taking the time to get to know each person and what drives them and what makes them unique actually is what lifts the morale in a workplace. When someone knows that you know me and you value me, it helps them know that if I disappeared tomorrow, you wouldn't be like, okay, we'll just fit another person in your slot. But actually, I'd miss you, I value you, I know what you bring to the table. So one thing you can do as a manager is simply start by using one of all these different assessments that are out there for teams. And we have a handout in the back if you guys want to pick that up with where you can go get some of these. But as I worked with managers who were struggling with an employee, or as I worked with teams who were struggling to get along, if we would do one of these assessments and just kind of get together and find out what are the strengths that each person brings to the table, what are they good at, and you start to lean into that as a manager. You say, okay, you actually like to take your time to think something through and put a plan together. I'm going to give you the time to do that, or value that or ask you to do that for the team because you're good at it. And so StrengthsFinder, if any of you guys are aware of that, helps you know kind of what each person's strengths is on the team. And it's not that they get to get out of something if they're not good at it necessarily, but you start to learn to, again, assign tasks according to the strengths that they have. And what I learned from one of these up here, you'll see the one called DISC, communication styles. I remember that's the first time I realized, okay, I'm more of a straight, direct, get it done, keep moving kind of communicator. And some people are more steady. And I found that when you communicate to someone else, you should try to actually communicate in their style versus your style. And found that there are actually people in the world who would prefer that you not say, here's what I want you to do, just go do it however you want to do it. That's what I would like, but I found out those in the S style, the steady, are like, no, give it to me. Indeed, I want to know what is it you want in the columns, you know, what is it you want as your header, so they can give you exactly what you're looking for as the leader, but also so they don't have to redo it, because you say go do it any way you want, and then they bring it back, and you're like, well, not like that, Can you, they're like, just tell it to me the first time. So learning some of those things about your group can really make a difference. I like conflict styles is great too, especially if you have a group that's not getting along. Learning all the various ways people manage conflict, which one you tend to use most often. And then also learning that actually every single style is valuable and learning to be more flexible with how you use your conflict style. So what this does not doesn't just help you get to know each other, but actually helps you let people kind of do work the way they do it. You're not going to change your deadline, and you're not going to change your quality standards, but you're going to let each person do their work what comes naturally to them. So one person might jump in, get going and rolling, and maybe that's your style, and you're like, great, they're moving. And the other person, you see them just kind of sit there quietly for 3 days as they think through each piece of it and they lay out a good plan. But in the end, they hit the deadline and they made it there steady. The other person who jumped right in might have gone back and forth and whatever, and oh, I don't like that and I messed that up, so let me go back and, you know, change it. But they get to the deadline and they get to the quality, and letting people do what they do best. And then the last thing that I think is so key for morale in a workplace is definitely self-care, building that place of trust where people can say, hey, I messed up, but recognizing people for the value they bring to the team. Taking the time not just to say good job, although some people just hearing that would make a huge difference, but also specifically saying thank you for all the creative ideas you bring to the team. Or thank you for the fact that you created a process that helped us. Actually calling out what they do best and assigning that value to the team and letting them know how they matter. And then being aware of definitely what they're dealing with at home and giving them that space to deal with it. So thank you very much. I hope this gives you guys lots of ideas for what you can do. And then we're going to go next to having you talk about how you can start to implement some of what you've heard this morning within your own workplace.
Man, you guys killed it. In a healthy way, you killed it. You know what I'm saying? That's good. All right. I'm up here just being a good leader, drinking water. No big deal. All right. So we got two questions for you that we want you to talk about at your tables. All right. The first one is, as a leader, I'll read it from here. How do you model taking care of your own health, physical, mental, emotional? And number two, what is one idea or strategy, if any, would you consider exploring or implementing following today's talk? So go ahead and have that conversation at your tables, and then I'll interrupt you again.
So I did learn one thing definitely that jumped out at me. There's some other things, but self-care is different than self-comfort. So I guess a big bag of Laura Scudder's barbecue potato chips and a liter of Coke is not self-care. Who would have thought? Who would have thought all that crud was not? Hey, we're going to make a little shift here because we want to talk about a little workplace. So we took the disc. So, okay, I'm going to let him tell the story.
I didn't know we were doing this. We took the Strength Finders test, both of us, actually the whole team, and one of my top ones was woo. And what he used to think...
Tell him what woo is.
Woo is, I get people to gather pretty well, and I can... Leah has a better description of it, but...
It's not manipulation like I thought it was.
And that's exactly what he said.
Work people to get them to do what you want them to do.
So you could use your powers for good or evil. Okay, let's just start with that. And I used to use my powers for evil. Now I know the Lord and I use them for good. But we didn't understand that about each other. And so Marvin was always kind of looking at me when I would woo people. He would be like, no, I know what you're doing. And I'm like, what, man? I love gathering people. I love having conversation. I love making new friends. Like, I want everybody to be my best friend. Every time I meet you, I'm like, hey, what's up? You want to be my friend? Hey, you want to be my friend? Let's be friends. And he was like, no, you just want something from him. I'm like, no, man, I just want to be their friend. But we were able to kind of learn to teach, work through that with each other. And so that's what we were sharing.
Thanks, John. And you know, so woo is, so when we took the Strength Finders, woo is like 37 or something on my list. So whenever I would see, right? So whenever I would see this woo thing, I think, you're trying to hit me up. What do you want from me? And I continue to grow in my strength and understanding who I am and who I'm not. So I grew up with, oh, I want to please you. Oh, I'll just do whatever you want, work my tail off, get sick, whatever that was, just to give you what you want because you're a wooer and you're just manipulating me. And so when we discovered woo, it's been the joke because I just have not, you know, I'm learning that that's not, it's okay to be a wooer. So we have a crab feed coming up. I'm going to have John woo you all to buy a ticket. You know, we've had it's been really fun. It's been really fun. I'm a context guy. I have to know history, background, context. Don't just tell me something. I need time to take a step back and consider and just some other things. So it's been fun. I do want to say that we've had a continued growing concern in a good way about the mental health and well-being, your well-being, the leaders of our community. Because I can tell you what, a city, an organization takes on the characteristic of its leaders. And we, as leaders of leaders, and we're not healthy, whatever that might look like in our wholeness, then that just trickles down. And whether it's a church or a nonprofit or a business, when the leader or the owner is not healthy, guess what? That does trickle down, and it impacts everybody. And so when I hear some of these talks, I think of indicators. I don't always think of, oh, my gosh, we're sick. I think, how do I know when I might not be healthy or functioning it from a healthy place? What are some indicators? Well, for me personally, of course, and it did used to be potato chips and a Coke. Now it's cynicism and complaining and being negative. So when my team knows I'm tired, I'll just get cynical. Oh, my gosh. There they are again. And I do my head like my mother would do it. Just do my head. I don't know. I must have got it from her some way. I love my mother. I was to say that after I said it. Oh, yeah. So I just get cynical. And I'm usually a pretty positive person. So, and even at home, I'll start picking at my wife, you know, about every little thing. I'll just start picking at her. And she'll finally just say, okay, go to bed. Really, she'll go to bed, get out of the kitchen or wherever, go to bed, you know. So indicators, start paying attention to your indicators that might be saying to you, oops, I might not be healthy. The other indicator that you might have around work, your workplace, and this is where I am, is that another thing is that how does the team react to me when I walk in a room? Now, whether I'm the boss or I write their checks or sign their checks, all that, put that away for a minute. How do they respond to you? Now, and I'm not talking about the lazy ones, right? You know, the ones that you got to put a fire underneath you and that under them, and that might be a whole nother indicator that maybe they need to go work somewhere else, right? If you got to keep putting a fire underneath them, that could be an indicator that maybe they need to go work somewhere else, or there's another issue, right? So just that. But I know when I walk in a room, I want to be able to have our team, or even those that I influence, walk in and say, "Phew. Marvin's here. It's okay now." Some of you might not see me that way, but I want to have that sense of, okay, we're going to be okay. There's a space here. We'll be all right. If you walk in a room and your team's anger rises or the anxiety level rises, that could be and I want to keep saying could be an indicator that something's not healthy there. So just some indicators on that. Our concern is that you are the gift. And I told you last time, you are the gift to our community. You are. And we want to take some responsibility to do we can to give you some ideas, some movement toward how do you be whole in every manifestation that there is. If you've come in over the last couple of weeks and last couple of months and said, oh, mental health, oh, we're going to talk about homelessness. We're not talking about homelessness. We're talking about us. We're talking about us because I'm broken, you're broken, we're all broken. First place to do is just admit that. You're a mess. I am too. It's okay. And what are we going to do about it and how we're going to support each other and encourage each other? We continue to invest in some numerous young leaders in our community. And, you know, the thing that they're starving for is to find each other and to have mutual support and encouragement. Just to be in a room together, to laugh. We just had a gathering on Monday. And I think our program, Maria, was about 5-7 minutes, with the Marias over there, about 5 to 7 minutes. And then literally for the next hour and a half, people stood around and laughed and talked and whatever they did. And I thought, oh, that says something to us. They don't want to get talked at. So that's why I'm going to stop talking now and let you talk. But our biggest concern, yeah, indicator, yeah, our biggest concern is you. And I hope you'll have some places. I want to encourage you, if you're in a place of self-comfort and self-care, and you've seen a pattern of that in your own life, first of all, admit that to yourself. And then I'd encourage you to find somebody that you trust to say, can I have a conversation with you? I trust you. Man, I'm having way too much self-comforts rather than self-care. Can you walk me through or just be my friend? Sometimes I need a 3-point outline for my friends, and sometimes I just need you to hear me. And so you'll have to maybe set the rules. Sometimes people will say things to me, and I'll say, so I need to stop right there. Do you need me to give you some direction, some answers, or you just need me to hear you? And let them set that tone for you. And I just need you to hear me. Cool. Okay, we're good. Go for it then. Or, no, give me some direction. Okay, I can do that. So I just want to encourage you with that going forward. Listen, you are the gift to our community. I'm telling you right now, and we're going to keep telling you that. We live in a generation of society right now where there just isn't enough of that communication. And I'm not about, you know, hug a thug kind of thing. I'm a hug a thugger, but, you know, oh my gosh, let's just pat everybody on the back. No, we're not that at all. You are the gift. You are the gift. And so treasure each other as well. You want to give me a hug? No. Yeah, you can give me a hug later. Thanks, Joe. Touch is one of my love languages. All right, put the slides on here. Some takeaways. So if you like more of this topic, Rooting for Rivals is one of the books that I've just been scrutinizing. But Rooting for Rivals is a book that might encourage you and help you. If you're a book person, there it is. If not, you're an audio person, fine, you can do audio. I've never looked up the YouTube to see if there's speakers because I like to mark my stuff up. So that might be something for you as well. I want to encourage you, if you've been sitting there and somebody else came to your mind about self-care or mental health of a leader or something that James said about the workplace. And by the way, I do know James's business. They're doing pretty well. They're doing okay financially. So I don't know all your business. So, oh my gosh, they're just rolling in dough. Make sure you just get some time with James. See what they're doing out at DataPath. Find somebody that you can spend time with. Let's just rip through the slides, and then I'll let you get back to talking. So next slide. I want to encourage you, next month we will have a panel discussion around these topics of wholeness and all its manifestations. And if you notice, I don't always say mental health because there's some of you in the room that have a real block around that phrase, mental health. So mental health, if that works for you, great. We want to talk about emotional well-being, whole well-being, until we figure out a phrase that works for you so you don't get a block in your head that all we're going to talk about is craziness. If you'd like to be a partner with us financially, please, you can just go to our website and click on Stripe and go from there. But we are a 501c3 nonprofit organization. And then finally, a couple other things. That's it. On the back table. Yeah. Thanks, Randy. Yeah. On the upcoming events here, back of the table, a couple other things. We do have a crab feed coming up for us, March 28th, and we want to ask you if you've had a benefit, if you benefited from Catalyst or some of the other things where City Ministry Network is up to. I'd love to have you. We're going to laugh. John Torres is putting it together and says there's going to be tons of crab. And it's at the Tuolumne River Lodge. It's the end of March. So grab a flyer, and you can go on the website and pay for it there. Also, too, want to encourage you, as we continue to try to identify indicators of where our leadership is going. So I'm going to have to get this now. Lots of times in leadership, we react to what has happened in our community. And so we've asked Reggie McNeil, who I listened to a few months back, what are some indicators, what are some things that we could begin to see that is happening around us that might give us some hints or hunches, as one of my friends say, hints or hunches about where we're going, who we're going to be. And here's why. Because if we can kind of get some hints and hunches about where we're going and who we're going to be, we can strengthen our leaders so that by the time we get there as a culture, society, as our city, our young leaders are ready. Because most of us train our leaders for the last war or the last thing we were going through. So I was trained in leadership in the 70s, so guess what? I was trained by men and women who were led in the 60s. which meant by the time I got into the 80s, I was still leading like the 60s. And the world had changed. So there's some ways we think we can help each other on that. So take a look at that. Love to have you be a part. And then we will get you going. And if you'd like the assets for teams, they're in the back as well, the slide with Leah. All right, let me thank God for you, and then let's get out of here. Lord, thanks for James and for Kourtney and for Leah for their wisdom. Wisdom. Lord, I pray that each one of us would learn to learn what it means to reflect, to think back, to gain wisdom, to create space in our life so that we can hear those voices in our head, or time to assess through journaling what's going on around me. Lord, I know I don't do that enough. And so, Lord, if there's somebody here that just needs to do that, to learn how to reflect and make space in their schedule, to be quiet, to think, hope they do that. And if there's somebody in here, Lord, and there probably is, that is just exhausted emotionally or even physically, I pray they admit it to themselves and admit it to a trusted person and get some coaching and some advice and some direction. Or take a day off if they can. In Christ's name. Amen. I love you guys. You're the gift. You keep remembering that. And Joe's going to give me a hug. Oh, where's Jeff Pishney? Jeff, where are you? You still here? Did you want, we good with Love Modesto? You sure? Hey, sign up for Love Modesto. You all know. There it is right there. Sorry, Jeff.